Ezekiel chapter 39. Father, we thank you tonight for your word. We thank you as we look at this passage, we might gain some insight and understanding here that might give us some confidence to trust you day by day in our lives for your glory. In Christ's name, amen. Chapter 39, verse number 1. Therefore, thou son of man, prophesy against Gog and say, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I am against thee, O Gog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and I will turn thee back and leave but a sixth part of thee, and will cause thee to come up from the north parts, and will bring thee upon the mountains of Israel. Now, when you read that, and you remember what we did last week in chapter 38, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, son of man, set thy face against Gog, the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and prophesy against him. Chapter 39 begins exactly the way chapter 38 began. In chapter 38, you read about Gog, Magog. Gog is the guy, Magog is his land, and you read about the other folks associated with him, and it's about the invasion of Israel. 38 verse 3, say, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I am against thee, O Gog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. I will turn thee back and put hooks in thy jaws, and I will bring thee forth, and all thy army, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armor, even a great company, and will with bucklers and shields, all of them handling swords and so forth. And he talks about Gog's army. He talks about gathering Gog and bringing God and invading the land of Israel. And we went over that, the details of how he's going to invade Gog, his cohorts and the people that work with him, and what happens in the invasion. That's what chapter 38 is about. And I tried to say to you in the last couple of weeks, looking at this passage, this is the last gasp, I call it, of the satanic policy of evil. This is the very last thing that Satan does. After the second advent of Christ, he's put in the bottomless pit. The thousand year goes. Ezekiel doesn't know anything about a thousand year part of the kingdom, and yet you have to remember that the only place in your Bible that you read about the kingdom having a thousand year beginning is in the book of the Revelation. Every dispensation in your Bible, starting with the very first one, has a transition into it. The dispensation of promise, which is the first dispensation, has a transition into it. They're in the garden. They're in innocence. They sin, and the promise comes. The law has a dispensation, a transition into it. The wilderness wanderings. The dispensation of grace has a transition into it. The first part of the book of Acts, the second part of the book of Acts. And the kingdom has a transition into it. That's what the millennium is about. Everything isn't settled in stone at the second advent of Christ. There is a process that begins with the second advent of Christ, him reclaiming and establishing the kingdom, but it takes a thousand-year period. In Revelation 20, Satan's put in the bottomless pit, and then after a thousand years, he's let out. So obviously the kingdom hasn't reached its final conclusion of being established until after Satan's let out of the bottomless pit. So there's a thousand-year period there when the kingdom begins, it's established, and yet everything isn't, all the answers, all the questions, all the issues aren't settled yet. And when you find them settled, and that's Revelation chapter 20, that's why in Revelation 20, after the millennium, the battle of Gog and Magog takes place. And I know I've read and listened and talked and studied and said through the years, you don't know where to put Ezekiel 38 and 39 because it. One minute you think it's the Antichrist, and you realize Gog is not the Antichrist. He's a Gentile, and then you realize that the things in chapter 38 aren't in the tribulation period, because verse number 8, after many days thou shalt visit, in the latter years thou shalt come into the land. So that's obviously prophecy. That's not in Ezekiel's day. That's not in coming back out of the captivity of Babylon. This is prophecy of the day of the Lord. So this is future from us. But what he says, they'll come back into the land, verse 8, that is brought back from the sword, and that it's gathered out of many people against the mountains of Israel, which have been always waste. But it is brought forth out of the nations, and they shall dwell safely all of them. In other words, he's brought Israel back from the captivity, brought them back into the land, and now they're dwelling safely. Well, that doesn't happen in the tribulation period. That doesn't happen before the tribulation period. All of Israel, none of them being left. That doesn't happen at the beginning of the 70th week. That doesn't even happen at the end of the 7th week. That's in the kingdom. And they're going to dwell safely. Verse number 11, thou shalt say, I will go up to the land of unwalled villages. So Gog's going to invade the land of Israel when it's unwalled. And I will go to them that are at rest, that dwell safely, all of them dwelling without walls and having neither bars nor gates. In the next verse, he talks about their riches. Here you've got Israel back in their land, all of them back in the land. Verse 8 said that they dwell safely, all of them, not part of them, all of them. If you look over at chapter 39, verse 22, so the house of Israel shall know that I am the Lord, their God, from that day forever. They're going to come back into the land. Verse 28, then shall they know that I am the Lord, their God, which caused them to be led into captivity. But I have gathered them unto their own land and have left none of them anymore there. None of Israel is left in captivity when this chapter takes place. Now, when you think about what that just said, as long as there's one Jew walking the streets of a Gentile city, that passage isn't fulfilled. So that's this chapter. These chapters are not about Gog and Magog. It's not about the Antichrist. Certainly not about the church age. You've got to be a preterist to do something like that. Somebody says, what does it mean to be a preterist? That means you had to fall off a log and hit your head real hard. But it's also not the tribulation. It's looking toward the end of the conflict that begins that transition period that begins the millennium. And that's why Revelation chapter 20 has it at where it does. And again, Ezekiel, Daniel, the earthly minister of Christ, they talk about a kingdom, but they don't talk about the millennium beginning it. Now, Revelation tells you about that because Satan lets him out. So at the end of letting him out, there's still something that needs to be settled. We'll talk about in a minute what it is. But Ezekiel 38 talks about that invasion. Then Ezekiel chapter 39, he repeats, I'm going to talk about it some more, but now he's going to talk about the result of what happens in chapter 38. So chapter 38 is the Gog, Magog, the invasion, their cohorts coming together up out of the north, and what happens when they do. Then in chapter 39, you're going to see the result. You're going to see the defeat of the satanic policy of evil and the triumph of God's plan for the earth. So chapter 38 is the invasion. That chapter 39 is the good stuff. Here's God resolves the problem, and you see an explanation for everything God has done with Israel in that fifth course of judgment. So go back with me to verse number two. And I will turn thee back, chapter 39, verse 2, and leave but a sixth part of thee, and will cause thee to come up from the north parts, and will bring thee up, bring thee upon the mountains of Israel. Now, when it says he's going to bring them from the north parts, we talked about that last time. If you look down in verse number 18, when he's talking about assembling the birds to eat up the enemy, verse 18, it says, you shall eat the flesh of the mighty and drink the blood of princes of the earth, of rams and lambs and goats and bullocks, all of them fatlings of Bashan. And when we get down to that passage, we'll talk a little bit more about what we did last time, about the forces from the north. Bashan is a, in scripture terms, is a stronghold for Baal worship. It's a place where Baal worship has its seat in the land of Israel. You remember Psalm 22 when Christ talking about the people around the cross, and he talks about the strong bulls of Bashan that leap on him. That's not just that was the Pharisees, but why would they're part of the Baal worship program that's opposing him. So when he's talking about coming from the north parts, there's a spiritual force animating the attack that's taking place. That's the point. And it's important to see that. Come with me over to the book of Zechariah just for a second. When you think about where this passage is in the book of Ezekiel, the next thing coming in Ezekiel is the temple. And chapter 40 to 48 is a passage everybody talks about the sacrifices in the temple and things that are there in the kingdom. And that temple is there so that Israel can teach the Gentiles God's ways. Well, that comes as a result of God redeeming Israel, putting them in the kingdom, and filling them with his glory. So Zechariah chapter number 2, for example. That's just a passage that's kind of a parallel thing. Zechariah chapter 2. I lifted up mine eyes again and looked, and behold, a man with a measuring line in his hand. Then said I, whither goest thou? And he said unto me, to measure Jerusalem, to see what is the breadth thereof and what is the length thereof. And behold, the angel that talked with me went forth, and another angel went out to meet him. And he said and said unto him, run, speak to this young man, saying, Jerusalem shall be inhabited as towns without walls, for the multitude of men and the cattle thereof. And read that, because here's a man, and this guy's looking toward the kingdom, and he's going to measure Jerusalem as a town without walls. That's just what we read in chapter 38. Part of the way Jerusalem's going to be when God comes out of it is they're going to be a town without walls. And the reason they're going to be without walls, a town without walls, for the multitude of men and the cattle. They're not going to have walls in this, not just because they're not any enemies attacking them. They've got so much going on in town, they can't contain it. You put up a wall and we've got to move the wall. You can't fence us in. The prosperity that's going to be there. For I, saith the Lord, will be unto her a wall of fire round about, and will be the glory in the midst of her. His glory is going to come and be on Israel, and God's glory is going to be protecting. They're not going to need an army. They're not going to need walls. They're going to have Messiah there to protect them. Verse 6 says, ho, ho. That's the Santa Claus verse. Ho, ho, come forth and flee from the land of the north. So where are they running from? The problem's up north. I was born and raised in southern Alabama. We always said that, but I've told people when my wife and I got married, we moved up to Dallas County, Alabama, started a church in 1970. My dad thought we'd join the Union. We'd only move 200 miles north. Well, this is more extreme north than this, and it's more extreme north than Chicago. This is the north of the land of Israel. Now watch what he says. Ho, ho, come forth and flee from the land of the north, saith the Lord. For I have spread you abroad as the four winds of the heaven, saith the Lord. Deliver thyself, O Zion, that dwellest with the daughter of Babylon. I just want you to notice the north is associated with what's going on over in Babylon. That's Baal worship. Where did Babylon come from? Genesis chapter 11, Tower of Babel, the propagation of Baal worship. And when you remember what happened back in Genesis 11, that's when God literally gave up the nations of the earth to walk in their own way and made the choice I'll make me a nation, and I'll show you what it's like to have me as a nation. You don't want me? You want the other gods of the world? Okay, I'll show you what it is if you have Jehovah as your God instead of all these other little dudes. So that rebellion and that giving up of the nations and setting the nation Israel aside for to be his nation, that takes place. That's all connected with the Tower of Babel. That's what Babylon is. Babylon is the headquarters of that. Revelation chapter 17, mystery Babylon. It's the counterpart of God's city, Jerusalem. There's God's throne in Jerusalem and his temple, and there's the satanic throne in Babylon. And more than just the city of Babylon, but the Baal worship associated with it. And it encroaches on the land of Israel, on the north side of the land of Israel in Bashan. Now, go back with me to Ezekiel 38. I said that just so that you understand things that are going on here. And by the way, hang on to Zechariah just a second. I'm sorry. Zechariah chapter 2 again. What comes after that discussion? Well, look down in chapter 3. And he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing with him at his right hand to resist him. And the Lord said unto Satan, the Lord rebuke thee. Now you've got the council meeting, the throne room of God. Now you've got the whole temple aspect. Look at chapter 4, Zechariah chapter 4. The angel that talked with me came again and waked me as a man that waketh out of his sleep. And he said unto me, what seest thou? And I said, I have looked, and behold, a candlestick, all of gold, with a bowl upon the top of it, and seven lamps thereon, and seven pipes. What's he talking about? He's talking about the menorah and the temple. Following along in the thinking process, now you go back to Ezekiel, and you've got what comes after this, the temple, and so forth. My point to you is that there's a thinking process that works through the historical development of the coming of Christ, the cleansing of the nation, the setting up of the kingdom, and the temple worship, that you're in back here in Ezekiel. So all of these things kind of work together. Now come back with me to Ezekiel chapter 39. And by the way, it's one fascinating thing about it in Ezekiel 39. And here's a verse that... And now you guys know me. I'm sorry. You guys been around me long enough to know. I read my Bible. I study my Bible. The Bible read the Bible. It tells me what to do. But when you start reading commentaries, the first thing commentaries want to do is tell you what the Bible ought to say instead of what it says. I start from the point of view, I've got the Bible. I don't need to find out what it says. I just need to understand what it says. Almost every commentator that I've looked at, everyone that I've looked at has said they don't know what verse 2 is talking about. When it says there, I will turn thee back and leave but a sixth part of thee, and will cause thee to come up from the north parts. He's telling Gog, I'm going to leave a sixth part of you. All the new Bibles change that. They either take it out, or they change it. Almost every commentary that I've looked at, and I've probably looked at a dozen, change it. A couple that don't say, I got no idea what that means, it can't be right, but we don't know what it ought to be. And I think, why not just leave it like it is? Makes sense to me. Well, then what's he talking about? Look, even when Satan is let out of the bottomless pit and goes out to deceive the nations, propagating the satanic policy of evil that he's been pushing all along, even then, it doesn't deceive everybody. Even then, there's still going to be some nations that he tries to deceive that don't fall for it. Now, that's fascinating. So the Lord tells me to start with, a sixth of you aren't going to get what you're doing. They're not going to buy what you're doing. And I think, wow, if you're the adversary and you're using your last big gun, and the Lord says, well, a sixth of you, not going to make it. The policy of evil doesn't deceive everyone, even at the hand of the adversary himself. So to me, I read that and I say, well, that makes me want to keep reading. Verse number 3. I keep looking at that clock, and I give up, okay? I'll go along the time says I can. Verse 3, 39:3, and I will smite thee. This is God talking, Jehovah talking to Gog. I will smite thy bow out of thy left hand and will cause thine arrows to fall out of thy right hand. Now, if you're talking to the army and you say, I'm going to smite your bow out of your left hand, your arrows out of your right hand, you're going to lose your weapons and all your ammunition. I'm going to disarm you. Thou shalt fall upon the mountains of Israel, thou and all thy bands, the people that is with thee. I will give thee unto the ravenous birds of every sort, to the beast of the field to be devoured. And we're going to read about that in detail down in verse 17 and following. Thou shalt fall upon the open field, for I have spoken it, saith the Lord. He looks at Satan and says, it ain't going to work, dude. I'm going to... Now, the thing to get here is the Lord says, I'm going to do it. Israel isn't going to do this. This is going to be a direct intervention of the Lord by himself, wiping these dudes out. I will send fire on Magog and among them that dwell carelessly in the isles, and they shall know that I am the Lord. That's the key. I'm going to send fire. Revelation 20 talks about it's fire that God destroyed. It's going to be a direct intervention from Jehovah, from the Lord God himself, where he stops all this stuff. Now, one question that comes up in my mind is, if this is at the end of the millennium, go back with me to Isaiah chapter 2. What happened when the millennium began? Isaiah chapter 2. And again, let me maybe if I just draw it up here, I can quit trying to think about how to say it. You have the cross of Christ. He ascends into heaven. The Holy Spirit comes on the day of Pentecost. The fall of Israel takes place. Here we are in the dispensation of grace, the body of Christ in here. The rapture, we go out, we go back to be with the Lord, and you have down here on the earth time that we call the tribulation period. The last 7 years of that tribulation is the seventh week of the book of Daniel. Bunch of stuff happens back here, the Antichrist is revealed here, and you have that seven-year period, and at the end of that, you have Christ comes back, and he destroys the Antichrist, puts Satan in the bottomless pit, and you have a 1,000-year period of time here where he sets up his kingdom on the earth. At the end of that, Satan comes out. This is the transition into the kingdom. After this, there's the great white throne judgment, the lost are put out here, and Christ delivers up the kingdom, and now you have the kingdom that extends out. In theology, call that the eternal kingdom. Now, I'm going to say it that way, but I'm going to tell you, if I say it that way, if you hold me to it, I'm going to tell you I don't think that's complete, okay? There's a phase of time period here, and that kingdom starts back here and goes out a period of time here. Then they start up, and then there are more phases of them that go out there, but that's not what we're talking about right now, okay? So don't let that confuse you, but I don't want to not acknowledge that. So here's the kingdom. Christ delivers up the kingdom to the Father. All the enemies are out of it now. 1 Corinthians 15. The last enemy is death. So during this part of the kingdom, there are enemies there. You with me? It isn't enemy-less here. It doesn't become enemy-less until after the great white throne judgment. Then the kingdom starts out here. Here's the new heaven and the new earth, Revelation 21, 22. You have that part, phase of the kingdom out here. Now, Ezekiel 38 and 39 fit here. The second advent fits there. If at the second advent, look at what happens, Isaiah chapter 2. The word that Isaiah the son of Amos saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. By the way, I'm having real problems reading with my... I got these readers, and they work good sometime, and they don't work good sometime, and tonight they're not working good. So I don't want to tell you what you guys look like, but I'm having a little... The light's giving me some problems reading. Verse 2, it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow unto it. When Christ sets up his kingdom, all the nations now come to him. We're going to see that later on in Ezekiel 39. He's going to establish Israel, and then the nations are going to come to Israel to learn about who Jehovah is. Verse 3, and many people shall go and say, come ye, let us go unto the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he shall teach us of his ways, and we shall walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. We're going to read about that in Ezekiel 40 to 48. And he shall judge among the nations, and shall rebuke many people, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. So the verse over in Joel says they take their plowshares, beat them into swords. That's in the tribulation, because they've got to go fight. Now they don't need to fight anymore. The fight's over. The Lord's there. He's going to defend them. They're going to take their swords, their armament, and beat them into plowshares. They'll take their swords, beat them into plowshares, their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. So when the kingdom begins over here, there's going to be a forced righteousness. You're going to have a real disarmament program. I saw a thing in the news this week, and they were talking about they're going to disarm Denver. Now, how do you think that's going to work? I know years ago I used to, when we church building was down in the city, a guy told me, he says, well, Chicago has absolute no gun laws. You cannot have a gun, carry a gun legal in the city of Chicago. That was true. About 60% of the people I met had guns in their pocket. I don't care what you say the law is. Some people are going to carry a gun. Some people know they need to, whether the law says they should or not. Wilson Avenue and Sheridan Road, where the old church building was, there was a, on the Wilson Avenue side, there was a row of parking meters the whole length of the street. One of the brothers in the church then, Roy Faber, it's back in the 1980s, he would park right outside that Wilson Avenue door. He'd never put money in the parking meter. I went out one day, I was going to put money in the parking meter. Roy said, don't do that. I said, Mr. Faber, he said, look, I'm willing to pay the fine if a cop will get out and put a ticket on my car. Half a block down, there's a precinct. We were there for years, and nobody ever put a ticket on their car. Parking meters expired. You'd think a cop ride by there, he'd see. And I asked a cop one time, he said, man, we've got so many other things to do. We don't have time to write parking tickets. So they had parking meters, but the parking meters wouldn't come down that side of town and write parking tickets because it's too dangerous. Now, how'd you feel about walking in the neighborhood? Well, somebody won't be carrying. These guys aren't going to have that problem because it's going to be enforced righteousness. And they're going to take all their weapons and demilitarize the zone where they live. Well, then how in the world are these dudes going to get weapons to invade with Gog? Well, that's where you have to kind of understand the nature of the kingdom at that time. Come back with me to the book of Psalms, chapter 110. And here's a passage that we quote all the time in connection with Peter on the day of Pentecost. Psalm 110, verse 1. The Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thy enemies thy footstool. The Pentecost back here, Peter standing there, and he quotes that passage to Israel. And he said, when Christ died, he ascends into heaven. The Father said to him up here, said, come and sit thou at my right hand until I make your foe, your enemies, your footstool. Sit down up here until I come bring you back over here, and I take your enemies and I subjugate them to you. Now, that's when the kingdom starts. But look at the next verse. The Lord shall send the rod of his strength. Now, what's that? Come with me to Revelation chapter 19. When you talk about a rod of strength, You're talking about something what you're going to enforce the rules with. We say, spare the rod, spoil the child. Well, nobody spares the rod. Well, everybody spares the rod now, so what are the kids, state of the kids? Well, not your kids, I know that, but what are you talking about, spoil the rod? You're talking about there's some discipline. There's some enforced righteousness. Revelation chapter 19, verse 11. I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. He's going to judge, he's going to make war in righteousness. Verse number 13. He was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed with fine linen, white and clean. This is the second coming of Christ, coming back down to make war. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them, watch, with a rod of iron. That's absolute enforcement of the rules. So when Christ comes back to set up his kingdom, he's going to come back and he's going to enforce the rules. Now go back to Psalm 110. The Lord shall, verse 2, the Lord shall send the rod of his strength out of Zion. Rule thou, now watch, in the midst of all your friends. Is that what that verse said? No. Rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. Now, verse 1, he says, I'm going to make your enemies your footstool. But that doesn't happen like that. And it doesn't happen, actually, until the end of that transition period. It doesn't, you know, you get the idea when you just see the simplicity of it, and especially on a chart, that it just all takes place at that moment. It doesn't just instantly materialize. There is a government that Christ sets up when he comes back that first has to extend over the whole planet. It takes some time for it to do that. And two, it then has to enforce righteousness. The only reason someone would die in the millennium is if they're, Isaiah says, a child dies at 100 years old. You die because you're executed. Well, if you don't break the law, you don't get executed. Look, if the law out there on that freeway said 55 miles an hour is a speed limit, if you go 56 miles an hour, we're going to put you in hell. You know what you'd do? You'd drive 53. And you know you would. If you know it's going to... Now, what you do is you drive 70, and you say, well, they give me 20 anyway, because everybody else is going 80, and you're in the way. And it's a relative thing. And the state of Illinois says, you know, they got a law in the state of Illinois that if you're in one of the left two lanes and you're impeding traffic, no matter how fast you're going, if you're impeding traffic, they give you a ticket.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why? Because you're holding up traffic. Yeah. Now, they might be going 80 miles between here and 355 down the road down there where I get off. 80 miles an hour is pretty much the standard. Posted limit is 55. And if you're over in one of those left-hand lanes and you're poking along, somebody's going to be behind you. Or in Chicago, they're going to be cutting you off, trying to put you in the ditch, get you out of the way. you know how it works. Won't be that way in the kingdom. And if, because sentence against an evil worker is not executed speedily, the hearts of the sons of men are fully set in them to do evil. Ecclesiastes 8:11. But if it is executed speedily, what happens? You step up. So what he's going to do, he's going to rule in the midst of it. Everybody in that thousand-year kingdom isn't his friend. That's my point. Look back at chapter 66. And you can just go through passage after passage like this. Psalm 66. And that's why there has to be a thousand. That's why there has to be that transition into it, because it isn't just instantly everybody gets it. We're going to study Ezekiel 40 to 48 where the nations are taught what Israel learned. It's going to take them some time. Isaiah 66, Psalm 66, I'm sorry. Make a joyful noise unto God, Psalm 66. All ye lands, Sing forth the honor of His name. Make His praise glorious. Say unto God, how terrible art Thou in Thy works. Through the greatness of Thy power shall Thine enemies submit themselves unto Thee. This is a psalm looking forward to that day. All the earth shall worship Thee and shall sing unto Thee. They shall sing to Thy name, Selah. Every time you see that term Selah, I know what people say, that's a pause note, supposed spot. That's a nice meditation, and that's fine. But when you see in the Psalms or in the prophets that term Selah, that's a code word for you to stop and understand the context of the Second Advent. This is a Second Advent psalm. In verse number 5, come and see the works of God. He is terrible in His doing, toward the sons of men. Look at what He's doing. He turned the sea into dry land. They went through the flood on foot. There did we rejoice in Him. He ruleth by His power forever. His eyes behold the nations. Let not the rebellious exalt themselves. O bless our God, ye people, and make the voice of His praise to be heard. There are going to be some people in that millennium that have rebellion in their heart. Let me show them to you. Come over to Zechariah chapter 14. Zechariah chapter 14. Zechariah 14, you have the second coming of Christ, verse 1, 2, and 3. Verse 4, He lands on the Mount of Olives. Verse number 6, the Lord shall be king over all the earth. In that day shall there be one Lord, and His name one. Your second advent, you're in the kingdom. Verse 16. It shall come to pass that everyone that is left of all the nations which came up against Jerusalem. All right, look here. Here the nations that come up against Jerusalem and all of them that get past the second advent into the kingdom. So who is it among the Gentiles going into the kingdom? Everyone that is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem shall even go up from one year to another to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and keep the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, we're going to read about that kind of stuff in Ezekiel 40 to 48 in the temple. So here are these dudes coming up, these Gentiles coming up to worship. And it shall be that whosoever shall not come up of all the families of the earth unto Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, even them, on them shall be no rain. Notice, there are some Gentiles out there that refuse to come. They're in the kingdom, seen the works, got in the kingdom, it's inaugurated, the worship's there, and they are still ain't cooperating. Well, what do you think they're going to think about the no gun policy? What do you think about it? Well, my point is that there's going to be a rebellion. Go back to Ezekiel. And so it isn't really unreasonable to ask yourself, well, where are all these dudes, Gog and Magog, where are these dudes going to get all the weaponry? Well, there's going to be a rebellious heart among those guys. And if you come back with me to Ezekiel 39, verse 5, for thou shalt fall upon the open field, for I have spoken it, saith the Lord God. Well, I love that. Look down to verse 8. Behold, it is come, and it is done, saith the Lord God. This is the day whereof I have spoken. So what I've said is going to happen, no matter what anybody wants to do about it, no matter what the adversary wants to do about it, no matter that last gasp of the satanic policy of evil to try to rebel against it, God said, this is what I said, this is what's happening. That's the kind of confidence you can have in it. It's absolutely certain. Verse 6, he said, I will send fire on Magog, and among them that dwell carelessly in the isles. You see what it says when they dwell carelessly? That word careless is like that verse over in Philippians chapter 4 when it says, be careful for nothing. You know, we get tripped up by that where we think if you're living carelessly, you're just being goofy and not. Carelessly, you don't have a care. These people aren't worried about what the king says. They're living confidently in their ability to avoid accountability. And he says, you know what they're going to do? Their heart's going to deceive them. Now, their heart's deceiving them. And when Satan comes out, he's going to deceive them into open rebellion. But again, if you know you're going to get a speeding ticket for going 56, you're going to go 53, and your heart's going to go. You know how it is. And you're not even in the kingdom rebelling against God. You just don't like Mr. Pritker's laws. Because you feel restricted. And often you are. But when God sets up the rules, you won't be in a restriction. Be righteous. But that whole sin nature, that old nature of rebellion. You see, if they aren't converted, if they don't get what Ezekiel 36, we saw Israel is going to say to the Lord about the Gentiles, do for them what you did for us. What do? He wrote his law in their hearts, put his spirit in them, gave them a new heart. He'll do that for the Gentiles, but they have to believe, they have to trust. They can't just walk in. And those that don't put their faith in Christ as their Messiah and their Redeemer and don't join Israel in understanding the program that God has for them, that old man's going to rebel. And when it does, it ain't going to be pretty. Now, come on back to chapter 36, verse number 7. For I will make my name holy, make my name, my holy name known in the midst of my people Israel. And I will not let them pollute my holy name anymore. And the heathen shall know that I am the Lord, the Holy One of Israel. Notice, Israel's going to know it, and the nations are going to know it. In that kingdom, Israel's going to know who God is, who Jehovah is. And the purpose of that is so that the Gentiles can know. Because the Abrahamic covenant was that in thee should all the nations of the earth be blessed. And over we've read in Ezekiel that you may know that I am the Lord God. I'm Jehovah Elohim. That you might really know. And my holy name, you're not going to pollute it. Behold, verse 8, it shall come to pass. It is come and it's done, saith the Lord God. This is the day whereof I have spoken. If you go back to chapter 38, verse 17, we saw that verse last time. 38:17, the Lord says, thus saith the Lord God, art thou, Gog, he of whom I have spoken in old time by my servants, the prophet of Israel, which prophesied in those days many years that I have would bring thee against them. God had been talking about this rebellion. He'd been talking about this satanic policy of evil, and now you're getting the Antichrist is the personification of the satanic policy of evil. We know that. We know how he operates. If that was the end of it, instead of putting Satan in the bottomless pit, he'd put him in the lake of fire, because you're going to put him in the lake of fire eventually. But there was one last thing that needed to be dealt with. He takes Satan out of the way, and the only thing left there is you. It's Adam. And for 1,000 years, he demonstrates that your human nature, man's human nature, the Gentile's human nature, isn't going to submit. And you can't blame it on the devil. You remember Genesis 3? It's the devil. Not blame the devil. And so, verse number 9, they that dwelt in the cities of Israel shall go forth and shall set on fire and burn the weapons, both the shields and the bucklers, the bows and the arrows and the hand staves and the spears, and they shall burn them with fire 7 years. I mean, this thing's going to be such a horrendous thing that happens, and it takes place like that. You go to Revelation chapter 20. This isn't a long thing. This Satan comes up. He gets these dudes to go with him. They gather their armaments together, and frap, the Lord ends it by himself. It takes 7 years to burn all the instruments. That means there's a bunch of them. Verse number 10, so they shall take no wood out of the field, neither cut down any out of the forest, for they shall burn the weapons with fire, and they shall spoil those that spoil them and rob those that rob them, saith the Lord. I mean, you're going to be in the kingdom, and they're still not going to need to go out and get firewood. Verse 11, it shall come to pass in that day, now watch this, that I will give unto Gog a place there of graves in Israel, and the valley of the passengers on the east of the sea, and it shall stop the noses of the passengers, and there shall they bury Gog and all his multitude, and they shall call it the valley of Hamon Gog. Hamon means multitude. And 7 months shall the house of Israel be burying of them, that they may cleanse the land. So 7 years it's going to take to burn up all the implements of war, and it's going to take 7 months to bury all the dead people. I love the thing where he says, it shall stop the noses of the passengers. You know, after a human body's been dead about 3 days, it's not commodious company to be in. When I was in school, back in Noah's day, I worked in a hospital. I was an orderly. I was a glorified bedpan slinger. And on weekends, I'd work in the emergency room. And one night, a guy came in. He'd fell out of a boat in Pensacola, Florida, and been in the river for 3 or 4 days. And they drug him up, and they took him down to the morgue. And I knew it was a county hospital, the county pathologist. And I'd been talking to him, and he came. He said, Jordan, you want to see the autopsy? I said, sure, I'd like to see the autopsy. So we go into the morgue, and the first thing that happens is you open the door, and the aroma comes out. And he looks at me, and I just instantly turned my stomach out, you know, inside out. And he laughed. He says, oh, Jordan, I forgot to give you your smelling sauce. And he took some stuff and put on right underneath my nostrils. So all you breathe is this really strong acid odor. And then you put on a mask. And by then I was ready to go somewhere else. This is not going to be a happy occasion. For 7 months. Now, seven in the Bible is associated, Numbers chapter 19, for example, with cleansing the land or a person that touches a dead body. So they're going to be cleansing the land from the dead bodies for 7 months. I mean, collecting up. It says, verse 15, the passengers that pass through the land, when any seeth man's bones, then shall he set up a sign by it till the buriers have buried it in the valley of Hamon Gog. In other words, all these people out here that are dead, their bodies decomposed, all that's left are bones. And if you, after they reflect them, now you see a guy over here, his body's just disintegrated, his bones are still there, and if you see it, put up a sign, because we got to bury these guys. We got to cleanse the land. We've got to stop. But in Ezekiel 37, there's a valley of dry bones. Remember that? God resurrects them, restores them, puts them all back together, and sets his nation together. And that's a testimony to the faithfulness of God to his word. Here's a valley of bones. Disintegrated, died, judged. And it's a testimony to the faithfulness of God's fidelity to his judgment. The guilty in no wise shall be cleared. So you have a contrast, 37, and here, another valley of bones. But this one, a testimony to the fidelity of God to hold accountable those who've rejected his truth. So we'll just stop there. My point to you is that the end of everything isn't here. That's why Revelation 20 has Gog and Magog over here. They don't know about a kingdom. They do know about that extended period of time of purifying the kingdom before it's delivered up to the Father. They know about, Revelation tells us it's 1,000 years. The reason you put this over here is because this is the last, this guy gets out and he's got one last attempt. Now, why would God do that? Because God's educating the Gentiles in here. We're going to see it in the latter part of this chapter. He takes the Israel and educates the Gentiles. Not just that Israel knows I'm Jehovah, but that the nations know it. And he's gathering out of the nations those that understand who Jehovah is, trust him, and then he's going to populate that kingdom with them. And the ones that aren't wise wind up down here in the lake of fire. So that's the result of the Gog and Magog battle. And I'm going to start with you verse 17 next time. We'll talk a little bit about the end of it. Because the explanation for everything God does in the fifth course of judgment is in that latter part of that chapter. And how the nations are supposed to respond to it. God was not careless with his people. He wasn't too weak to defend them. Something entirely different. So the deception of the adversary doesn't work. Okay? All right. Praise the Lord. Okay. Aren't you glad you're saved by grace? Don't have to worry about it. And aren't you glad you get it up front? To me, one of the greatest things about grace is the moment I trusted Jesus Christ, God gave me in his Son everything he has for me. I ain't got to wait for any. Only thing I'm waiting for is to the last installment. That's the new body to take us there. And the only reason he's waiting on that, that's already assured you. He's leaving that just because it's extended the day of grace another day. But other than that, everything he has for you, you possess it. And you think, well, that's a wonderful. There's no trial period. All right, Father, we thank you tonight for your word and thank you for the privilege of studying it and being a part of a ministry that makes these things known, for Christ's sake. Amen. All right, praise the Lord.